Good afternoon. Welcome to the concluding lecture of the winter-spring lecture series on environments. And we end with a, I think, entirely appropriate lecture tonight by Brian Holland. I will read for a moment to get the full flavor. Brian Holland is the 2009-2010 Edward E. Lefevre Fellow at Ohio State University's Knowlton School of Architecture. He comes to Columbus following 10 years of architectural practice with offices in Los Angeles, Denver, and New York, most recently a senior designer in the office of Winkel Dubbeldam. Brian has been a visiting assistant professor at the American University of Beirut, and in 2008 he was the nominee for the Chernikov Prize. He holds a Master's of Architecture from the University of Pennsylvania, a Bachelor's of Architecture from Cal Poly Pomona. Brian's research at the Knowlton School is centered on urban agriculture as a means of environmental entrepreneurialism and infrastructural transformation. His interest is in approaching architecture as an action before object, as a sequence of strategic operations within a complex field of cultural, material, and economic systems. By the careful manipulation of existing forms, his work gives rise to a unique spatial condition and programmatic invention while simultaneously achieving an economy of action. And the results of Brian's work, which we'll see tonight in the lecture, is also followed by the current gallery exhibition, Future Farm City, which is currently on display, and there will be a reception following the lecture immediately, so I encourage you all to go down the ramp and join Brian in the gallery for further conversation. I just wanted to offer a personal note on Brian's time here as a fellow. I have appreciated the way he's brought his research interests through his studio work and engaged the school and his colleagues, I think, in a totally prescient issue of the city as it moves forward. And with that, please welcome Brian Holland.
How's the volume? Can you guys hear me? Let's just get the systems working right. How's the volume in the back? Good? Great. So thank you, John, for the introduction. And I should also, at the beginning, thank the Knowlton School for the opportunity to serve as this year's Lefevre Fellow. I've enjoyed the opportunity and I'm happy to be here tonight to share with you the research that I've been doing this year, which was done also in association with students in my architecture studio this quarter in the spring, and also with a studio in the landscape department taught by Catherine Bennett and Jake Boswell. And that work, as John mentioned, is in the gallery. So tonight I'm going to try to set up the topic for you, look at some models of urban agriculture that have been proposed in the past, then specifically try to develop an argument for what a model of urban agriculture could be for a city like Columbus, which for me represents a kind of typical American city, one that's characterized largely by a sort of low density horizontal sprawl. Because I think it's a question that hasn't been asked really surprisingly, despite the amount of interest in the subject of late, to ask the question about urban agriculture not for, say, New York or London, but to look at the typical American condition. So you may have seen images this weekend in the New York Times or on the BBC's website of an event that took place in Paris where the French Young Farmers Union brought a temporary farm to the Champs-Élysées in Paris as a way to call attention to the economic plight of France's farmers, and as well as just in general to engage Parisian citizens in a kind of provocation about the place of agricultural or rural systems within the city, and the way that this displaces the typical scene of the Champs-Élysées and sets up a kind of a sort of rural fair of sorts. And as you can see, the amount of interest in the subject is clear by the numbers of attendees. This kind of event, cultural event built around agriculture, wouldn't seem unfamiliar to anyone who knows WorkAC's project for PS1's annual Young Architects competition, in which they traded the typical or traditional theme of the urban beach for the warm-up party. They traded that theme for the kind of celebration of the urban farm, which basically brings a kind of questions of sustainability to the foreground, clearly, in their proposal, but also tries to celebrate a sort of notion of country life, sort of incongruously within the city. But we can see that these sorts of manifestations of urban farming or a kind of zeitgeist about agricultural culture is happening sort of everywhere. And whether it's rooftop farming or pickup truck farms or political statements in front of City Hall, or as virtual manifestations as well, as teenagers tend to their virtual raspberries on Facebook, or as it even approaches the world of high design, with Karl Lagerfeld staging a fashion show around the idea of the farm, with the catwalk transformed into a rural scene within a replica of a traditional barn designed after one owned by Marie Antoinette, no less. So in search of more sustainable modes of practice, I think it's clear that architects are looking to urban agriculture as one possible means of a kind of infrastructural transformation within the city. And as unexpected as these sorts of images, which images of kind of designers with chickens seemingly trying to call forth a kind of legitimacy by use of the prop of the chicken, right, as a kind of mode of a sort of evocation of values as a designer. I think that we shouldn't be completely cynical about such images as merely kind of a greenwashing, but I think potentially, or what I'll argue tonight, is that they do represent a kind of valid attempt by designers to try to articulate the shifts that they are seeing happening within society. So, as clumsy as they may be at the moment, I think that there's a kind of larger question about the role of design, and specifically architecture, in a sort of new era of concern about the environment, of concern about scarcity, and a new way of operating, and finding a new way to operate as designers within this sort of condition. So we know the references, we know the kind of cultural zeitgeist, right? We have, on one hand, we have very real environmental concerns that we face, and they're sort of overwhelming in their scope potentially, but they pose very real questions to the role of architecture in society, or the role of architecture to produce better conditions for human civilization. And on the other hand, we have very tangible issues about concerns about food security, health, and nutrition, and which are sort of become clear anytime you walk into a bookstore and you can see a sort of whole cornucopia of critiques of the modern industrial food system and any number of calls for sort of local foods, organic foods, or films exposing the ills or evils of factory farming or the fast food industry. And this cultural transformation manifests itself in a couple of ways very directly, one of which is the rise of farmers markets in the US, which are at this point climbing above 5,000, the number of farmers markets in the US currently, which over the past 15 years or so has more than tripled in terms of the number of farmers markets. Also, the growing interest in CSAs, or Programs for Community Supported Agriculture, where people support in advance financially local farmers in order to basically buy a share of their production for the season, in return for which you receive a weekly box of produce from the farmer. So a kind of establishing a reciprocal relationship, a more direct relationship with people and urban citizens and the people who produce their food. So clearly there's a kind of suspicion or critique of practices we've come to know through these sorts of films and sort of journalistic exposés about the environmental conditions which underlie our industrial food system and the practices that feed us daily and leave us somehow disconnected, with a sort of profound sense of disconnection between our food and how it's produced and who produces it and under what conditions. So how did we get to this place? How did we get to this state of being so kind of fundamentally disconnected from an understanding of our material culture and the food and our food and its production? Because it wasn't always this way. If we look back to the medieval city, there was a much more direct and legible relationship between the urban dweller and the surrounding productive landscape, simply by means of scale on one hand, but also by means of technologies, where even if one lived in the city, most likely one was involved directly with the physical efforts behind the production of food and the management of the agricultural landscape. This all changed, of course, however, after the Industrial Revolution, when the distances between food production and food consumption began to increase dramatically, largely by way of the railroad, where essentially now the Midwest could become the farm for New York City and the East Coast, so that one no longer even saw where the food was produced or how it was produced. But also, ultimately, in terms of the technologies that began to underlie agricultural production. So, as a result of that kind of shifts that we saw with the Industrial Revolution, and the scaling up of the distances between the city and the farm, there were a couple of models proposed for city plans which would try to, from the beginning, reserve a place for agriculture within the city, one of which was Howard's Garden Cities of Tomorrow, which you see on the left, a kind of diagrammatic plan, which tries to set up a kind of hub and node system where the central city is surrounded by a series of smaller towns, but in between is an agricultural landscape. Even within higher density cities, proposals were made here by Corbusier, for example, where Space within the city, within the urban fabric, was reserved for agricultural production. In this case, Corbusier argued for 150 square meters, I believe, of production per household, which would then get linked up into larger fields, which could be managed by commercial farmers on one hand, but then would provide a sort of outlet for physical activity and a kind of psychological improvement by engagement, by one's engagement with the garden. That sort of density, however, is quite different than the proposal that Frank Lloyd Wright had for Broadacre City, which tries to engage the kind of agrarian roots of the United States, but clearly also betrays Wright's hatred of the density of the 19th century industrial city, or in this case, it was 20th century when he was developing this proposal. But his proposal here was for a kind of low density, horizontal, automobile-based city, which allowed each resident to have a minimum of 1 acre of cultivatable land, by which they would provide for themselves. And even today, in sort of rethinking the master plan as a way to deal with existing cities of large density, Work AC's recent proposal for what they call the mega agropolis takes the density, the existing density of New York City and the surrounding area, and proposes to, on the right, consolidate, dismantle the suburbs and consolidate consolidate the population into smaller agricultural towns, and then create a sort of massive, what they call arc of humanity, centered at Newark, New Jersey, which becomes a sort of mega agropolis. So it's a model that tries to argue for essentially densifying the city and producing more local produce within what they're saying is the magic 100-mile radius of the locavore diet. So the idea is reorganizing the entire 100 miles surrounding New York City to achieve the kind of dream of a 100-mile diet becomes an interesting sort of notion, but one that I think is specifically critiquing actually one of the major models right now of urban agriculture, which is that of the vertical farm. Work AC's proposal argues against the vertical farm and argues for a kind of soil-based agriculture, an organic agriculture, but the vertical farm actually is precisely the opposite. So the vertical farm is a concept that comes out of New York City and Columbia University's Dixon Depommier, and he argues for essentially concentrating all agricultural production within a series of 30-story towers full of agriculture, and then allowing the countryside, the agricultural countryside, to revert to wilderness. And this, in a sense, is because his argument is that the sort of massive environmental impact that agriculture has should be counteracted by abandoning the countryside, of stripping it of agriculture, letting it return to wilderness, and farming ultra locally. So the idea that New York would have 150 30-story towers of agriculture to feed itself, to him, is an argument for a sustainable approach. And architects have really answered the call to this. If you search the blogosphere, in 5 seconds you'll have a whole array of proposals of vertical farms. Here's one we can see on the waterfront of Chicago. So where we might have seen just a couple of years a condominium tower on the waterfront of Chicago, now we see heads of lettuce occupying the same penthouse space. And even other proposals here which start to address other sorts of architectural typologies, like the continuous surface becomes the continuous hydroponic farm in the proposal on the left. So the vertical farm, however, has its critics, and one of whom seems to be Winnie Moss of MVRDV. His recent project, which we see here, used the approach that was used in the MetaCity Datatown proposal to look at sort of the raw numbers of agriculture. So to ask the question, okay, if the goal is for New York City and specifically Manhattan to produce all of its own food on the island of Manhattan, what would really be required? So it becomes a sort of approach to visualize the data. So what they've done is collected, as you can see on the image on the right, every color tower represents the quantity of area needed to feed all of Manhattan of each particular crop that they were looking at. And so kind of we can see the sort of ridiculous premise of the vertical tower of, I don't even know how high this would be, but what's clear is on the in the image on the left is that if they were to distribute all of this indoor food production on top of the existing buildings of Manhattan, it would basically double the height of every single building. So the question of the local diet taken to its extreme conclusion seems to be rather absurd, revealed as rather absurd in this proposal. So it's a question of how dogmatic does one want to be with questions of local food production. So as Sarah Cole said once, local food production for New York is great, but that's what New Jersey is for. Right? So there's a second critique though of the industrial, of the vertical farm, which is sort of it's that it represents the kind of ultimate conclusion, in my opinion, of the sort of single variable optimization of industrial agricultural logic, which seeks to control every input and output and leaves no agency for natural systems. So as you can see here in this sort of highly artificial environment where sunlight, water, and nutrients are all delivered by the agency of man. And I think it's particularly evident when I look at this image, which is from a 1970 National Geographic, which is a rendering from this particular issue of the farm of the future. So as it was seen in 1970, which has a sort of Jetsons quality with this sort of modernist bubble control tower on the left, and then on the right you'll see a kind of series of cattle towers and a monorail which delivers the grain to the city in the distance, and each of these cattle towers is then fed by pneumatic tubes which delivers the feed to the animals. So I think there's not too much difference in these two proposals. So in 40 years we still have a certain kind of tendency to want to control fully all of the variables that underlie agriculture. And in my opinion, we're in danger of making some of the same mistakes as in the past, where I think clearly Dixon de Pommier's argument that the system is broken is right, but the answer to me seems not to be that we should abandon the agricultural landscape where soil, water, and sun are all present essentially for free. So why it seems that the vertical farm, while cloaked in the sort of language of sustainability, argues that one should pay for essentially what nature would do for free, which seems to be somehow against the first principle of sustainability. So I want to move away from the vertical farm as a model, and certainly not as a model for Columbus. So on the flip side of the vertical farm, which represents the kind of top-down approach to the design of agricultural systems, The community garden represents a bottom-up approach, which, unlike the vertical farm, which remains very theoretical, the community garden is actually the most prominent form of urban agriculture in this country right now. And it often is very small in scale, is often in very sort of poor or neglected neighborhoods with lots of vacancies and fragmentation. And it allows residents to empower themselves by way of providing for their own food security or supplementing their diet due to the presence of, or the sort of, the presence of food deserts, what are called food deserts, where many parts of the inner city people don't have access to fresh produce. So the community garden represents another kind of model which is quite real and quite powerful. And as you can see, as I said, concentrated often in the sort of lowest income areas of the city. But the community garden, if it were ever to become infrastructural, the question of how it scales up becomes problematic because of the marginalized status of agriculture within the city. It's typically seen agriculture is a low economically valued enterprise within the city, and so it's often in competition with other development, and so it's typically a kind of transitional or temporary use. So in this example here of the South Central Farm in Los Angeles, which was at one point the largest community garden in the country, a developer following the early 90s riots in Los Angeles granted the temporary usage of this property to a local community group, which established a farm which was inhabited mostly by minority populations and immigrants, which became wildly successful and fed something above 500 families. But as the city began to prosper again after the riots, the developer eventually revoked their right to use the property in order to develop a warehouse. So the sort of emotional issues that surround this kind of connection that people establish to the land, which is then revoked, becomes one of the problems surrounding community gardens and presents real limitations for how it could scale up to an infrastructural level. So there is, however, one example from the 1940s during the time of World War II in which this kind of bottom-up agricultural production by way of community gardens did actually scale up to the level of infrastructure, in which case people by their own efforts were producing a large percentage of the food consumed by the nation. And that's the idea of the Victory Gardens, in which there was a sort of political or patriotic effort to support the war, to support the troops by growing food on one's own. And in the case of Europe, where literally supply lines had been cut by the war, countries became more interested in self-sufficiency, and there became a sort of patriotic call for support of local food production. So it's an interesting example of how, with enough sort of motivation for change, there could be an infrastructural implication to this sort of bottom-up approach to urban agriculture. And there's also one other model I'd like to present which illustrates the potential of community gardens to become a kind of master plan for urban agriculture, which is this proposal by the architects from London, Bone and Villon, which stitches together a series of community gardens and even commercial farms into what they call the continuous productive urban landscape. So a series of agricultural and recreational corridors which move through the city fabric to create a kind of cultural status for agriculture within the city. So no longer are the community gardens fragmented and marginalized and often even unknown, but they become part of a larger recreational strategy, a green space strategy for the city, which connects culturally food production and recreation and outdoor leisure. So their proposal calls for the strategic closing of a few streets in order to achieve this goal, but I think overall is interesting in how it manages to deal with the existing city rather than proposing a kind of new city of agriculture, and as well generates a kind of legibility of the master plan by way of this sort of bottom-up approach. And I think that's really where the work that I've been doing, which looks at Columbus, takes a starting point from the continuous productive urban landscape as a sort of conceptual strategy. But the first question one needs to confront is the corridor of agriculture model really suited for a kind of low-density sprawl city like Columbus? So if we quickly look at the statistics, if we compare the success of the corridor model in London, we can see that the cities of Columbus and London are similar in their geographic extent, but wildly different in terms of their population density. So to me, it seems that the corridor model wouldn't work in such a kind of low density condition. So the question then becomes, what is the approach? How would one find a sort of opportunistic, entrepreneurial, bottom-up approach to a kind of legible agricultural plan for Columbus, Ohio? And this is where I'm arguing for what I'll call the hybrid field. So rather than localize agricultural production into a few locations in the city, the hybrid field envisions a kind of ubiquitous presence of agriculture. And it does so by looking at the sort of dross or waste of the horizontal sprawl as opportunity. So if we could imagine reading the city's potential through a series of agricultural overlays to produce hybrid conditions and therefore opportunity. So whether that's, as in this proposal, a competition entry to the Dwell Reburbia competition for suspending aeroponic agriculture above a parking lot for a strip mall in Arizona, where the agriculture simultaneously shades the vehicles as well as provides access to sun. It's an example of an insertion where agriculture isn't competing for land use with other development types, but rather symbiotically connects with the programs. Similarly here, in the most typical example, you have the rooftop farm or the window farm as spaces which are already being used for other purposes, but then get overlaid with agricultural production. So in the sense, the rooftop farm has an advantage over the land-based community garden in that it doesn't compete for land use with other buildings, but rather finds a niche with which to occupy agricultural production, and then simultaneously becomes even more successful as an agricultural enterprise in terms of, in this case of the farm in Greenpoint on the left, this farm never has trouble getting volunteers who want to come on Saturday, enjoy that view, and participate in the labor of food production. So what I'm calling for is a model of hybridization between urban programs and agricultural programs, which doesn't see the two as in fundamental opposition, but rather sees synergistic combinatorial possibilities. So another example here is from about 15 years ago from the Dutch architect Klaas Oosterhuis, in which he proposes to combine commercial greenhouses and residential courtyard houses into one sort of hybrid proposal, within which, if we look at the sort of, you have on the bottom level the residential houses, which are courtyards. So the openings you see in the skylight become courtyards, surrounding which are the houses, and the commercial greenhouse is put on the upper level. And so in this way, you enter your house from the upper level and proceed down into the house, and then there becomes a kind of thermal exchange between the greenhouse and the house, so that the residences are kept warm in the winter and likewise cooled in the summer by way of the presence of the greenery. So it's an interesting model that's not doesn't see development as a threat to agriculture, but sees it as a possible condition of hybridity. And then again, as in another example by a student at the university in Toronto, which looks at the possibility of combining the office park typology with agricultural greenhouses as a kind of adaptable, flexible system in which each module of the structure could be infilled either by office program or greenhouse program, depending on which way the economic winds are blowing. So this is a kind of strategy of hybrid typologies in which which looks at the city as a series of replicable generic urban development types and looks at a series of agricultural production types and their possibility for being combined or hybridized as a way to insert agriculture into the city in such a way that it's close to people and has the ability potentially to influence the culture, as well as a way to avoid the sort of economic hardships of agriculture when it's strictly land-based. So this idea of the possibility of an industrial park complex becoming a sort of distributed pasture grazing scheme, rooftop pasture grazing scheme, or the vacant spaces or backyards of a downtown or of an urban neighborhood, presenting the possibility of small-scale commercial and domestic greenhouse systems, or which looks at the tower as a sort of vertical greenhouse whose facade only could be used for agriculture while still allowing other programs to take place within the building. This is the approach which I argue as being appropriate to this kind of horizontal city that we, the conditions of which we understand here in Columbus, in such that the legibility or the cultural status of the agriculture comes by way of its eventual ubiquity. Once the city begins to understand the waste spaces or the underutilized spaces in the city as a kind of new frontier, a sort of opening of a new agricultural frontier, one which is close to the population. So the kind of economic or entrepreneurial opportunities within the city start to present themselves when you read an image like this in which the agriculture becomes ubiquitous, but also in which you can start to see different typologies present in different sorts of territories within the city. So the cultural status comes from reading the city as a series of images. We understand the image of the downtown. We understand the quality of space in the suburbs. We understand the quality of space in urban neighborhoods. And each one of those is particularly suited to supporting agriculture in a certain way. And so therefore produces kind of legible forms. So What I want to do now is show you the results of the research that was conducted in the studio, in my architecture studio this spring, along with the graduate students, where we looked at the city of Columbus as a series of five territories, and within which each territory had particular types of building typologies, which we then overlaid agricultural production systems onto. So, first to show you in the downtown territory, it became clear in the studio that there was an opportunity presented by the vacancy of downtown. So, the vacancy of parking lots, the vacancy up to 30% of office buildings, to kind of create the possibility of these sort of squatter farms, if you will, where basically a module is developed to support a kind of private garden typology, which is placed either in vacant parking spaces or in vacant facades of office towers. So it becomes a kind of mobile production unit, which is totally opportunistic. Another example of how that could scale up is the idea of a facade renovation to a high-rise, which inserts a kind of hoop house or high tunnel, informal greenhouse, into each bay of the facade, according to the sort of whim of the tenants or the building owner, so that agricultural production can begin to colonize the facade of the tower. So this starts to build a kind of notion of what we call civic agriculture within the city, within the center city, which starts to argue for a kind of new vision of life surrounding agriculture and food within the city, whereas right now it's quite vacant. So the production of this new facade farm could start to build a culture of food carts and markets at the street level. So, and also can make an argument for subverting the distribution chain, which right now on the top of the image trucks food from the rural farm to the distribution center to the supermarket, which the consumer drives from their house to the market to pick up the food and then back to the house. In this way, the idea that a sort of entrepreneurial facade farmer on a high-rise tower downtown could essentially set up a food cart or local farmer's market at the lower level of the tower or on the street or in the parking garages means that employees of the downtown office buildings could pick up their fresh produce on their way home instead of making a special trip to the supermarket. So it becomes a kind of entry into the distribution chain. Another proposal looks at suburban neighborhoods and creates two different hybrid typologies, which in one case is the big box greenhouse. And the big box greenhouse takes advantage in particular of an interest on the part of even large corporations and the part of selling local food, such that food is produced locally in the building. And in a mezzanine condition, a greenhouse mezzanine, which slices through the existing building roof, and then at certain point comes down to the ground to surround the produce department and as well as to provide the opportunity for a kind of U-pick greenhouse where patrons of the store could directly pick their produce from the greenhouse. It's an interesting proposal because it takes advantage of a sort of wasted volume of space within the big box, as well as provides an interesting boost potentially to the sales of the commercial, of the big box operator. There was an interesting case that came up in our research, which was that there was a Walmart that was built in California where they ran out of money halfway through and value engineered out the skylights. So half was built with skylights, half was built without skylights. And they found after some study that their sales were higher in the part of the store that had skylights. And so the idea that the greenhouse can not only provide opportunities for local food production, for an entrepreneurial agricultural operation, but also can simultaneously boost the sales of the store. So it becomes a kind of reciprocal relationship between the two programs. One that also becomes reciprocal with regard to a climate exchange, where there's a gas exchange set up between the CO2 and O2 production of the two systems, as well as usage for the rainwater collected from the roof and thermal discharge of the occupants. Another example, another hybrid typology from the suburban neighborhood, looks to insert agricultural row crops within the typical suburban subdivision. So basically this is achieved by taking part of the backyards and consolidating them into a sort of single or double tractor run of agricultural production. And what this is responding to is the pressures on exurban farmers who want to expand their operations but no longer have the ability to buy up new land. And so the possibility that the farm could extend into the city is an interesting one in this proposal. Also, because with the idea that there will be a rise in demand for local food, there can be a sort of clear understanding that farmers will need to expand their operations in one way or another. So the idea that you can establish a sort of reciprocity between a commercial agricultural enterprise and its neighboring suburban development is an interesting one for me. So the proposal is to allow the sort of shared backyard condition of the houses to support row cropping, but then periodically over certain seasons, the sections of the subdivision which go fallow, where the crops go fallow, then become accessible again to community space. So it's a kind of model which changes over time. And also importantly is one that begins to establish a sort of stewardship on the part of the residents. So by collecting rainwater, you support the irrigation of your sort of local section of farm. Even shown here is the possibility of bee husbandry, which supports pollination of the crops, as well as strategies of compost collection, of food scraps collection to support composting programs, which then are returned to the residents by way of a sort of community-supported agricultural system. So that somehow this scheme starts to establish a kind of call for a stewardship, to me, is one of the strengths of the model. Another territory we looked at was distribution warehouses, so warehouse clusters. So in certain parts of the city, we get large agglomerations of sprawling distribution warehouses, which when we look at the scale of these buildings, they're really very similar to the scale of a typical kind of row crop farm. A monoculture farm. So this proposal simply looks at the rooftops as an opportunity for large-scale agricultural within the city, which then becomes accessible to residents as not only agriculture but recreational space. So the idea that suddenly spaces which were before entirely void in the mind of this of the urban residents now become re-accessible. So warehouses are organized in such a way as to connect closely together to provide for the continuity of agricultural farming on top. And then in the cavities between where the sort of parking and loading occurs becomes opportunities for ecological intensification, for runoff, for handling runoff and habitat production in support of the farm. The last example I want to show you looks at the urban neighborhoods with two proposals. So in sort of higher density inner city conditions, the greenhouse model suggests a reciprocity between commercial operators and residential greenhouse owners, whereby each resident would have the option to accept the usage part-time or full-time of their backyard for either to be operated by the commercial greenhouse manager or to sort of put up their own high tunnel or hoop house, as it were, seasonally. So, but then allowing them to plug into a larger greenhouse infrastructure. So this presents the opportunity to transform the neighborhood in an interesting way, which provides a local source of fresh food, as well as a gathering spot for communities. And another interesting typology was what combined rotational grazing systems with the same urban neighborhoods to create a kind of backyard grazing scheme. So the rotational grazing strategy is one in which the residents can make available the use of their backyards to any proportion with which they're interested for the temporary and sporadic use of grazing livestock. So the rotational grazing scheme looks at pastures, basically isolates small sections of pasture, fencing cattle or other livestock into a small area with which they graze vigorously to promote further renewed grazing or growth of the pasture grazes, grass. From which then the livestock are moved subsequently to separate pastures by way of movable fences. This is typically. So in this case, we're looking at the suburban neighborhood as already a subdivided pasture in which an infrastructure is proposed of movable fences or retractable fences, rather, that allow separate paddocks to be established for the animals and to move through the yard over time. So the idea that you have access to your backyard for the majority of the month for your own recreational use, but on a certain number of days when the animals are passing through to graze, the fences are deployed and the animals graze, and then within a couple of days, the manure is composted and the grass begins to regrow and you have access again to your yard. So, and this produces a whole series of innovations at the alley in order to handle runoff, both from, to keep the farm functions and the residential functions separate, and also here for the possibility of introducing orchards into the alleys as well. So the kind of direct engagement with agricultural systems and the kind of stewardship possibilities within this, as well as the economic opportunity, for me, here are the interesting, present the interesting possibilities for what a kind of future farm city could be for Columbus and by extension the horizontal American city, one in which agriculture becomes ubiquitous by way of its overlay, a combination with urban programs, and starts to develop a culture of production and a sort of degree of stewardship which, in my opinion, can point the way towards a kind of new urban condition which is both agricultural and urban at the same time. Thank you.
Particular
Right. Well, I mean, the question of diet is a big one, because obviously it's the way that we eat to a certain degree that's produced the way that we farm today. I mean, there's sort of a chicken and the egg thing, because on one hand we make a lot of stuff with corn because we produce a lot of corn, like it retains economic value and stores well. So, but I think, you know, the proposals that we were interested in and the approach that we took didn't start to work kind of backwards from, okay, what will we, you know, sort of what do people want to eat, and what's the scale, how many people, and therefore what do we need? It simply looked for niches within which to operate and proceeded from there. So I think the extent of any of these systems would sort of self-organize based on supply and demand. So the idea that, I mean, we looked at the quantities, for example, in the grazing scheme, the backyard grazing scheme. So the idea that a CSA kind of model, you provide your yard, you make your yard accessible to this entrepreneurial livestock company, and in exchange, it seemed that based on this case study of Franklinton that was looked at by the students, you could have something like, I think it, something like a hamburger a week, was it? Or like a gallon and a half of milk per week. So there's a kind of interesting, I mean, it's certainly not providing food for the whole city, but I think the other question is, you know, typically it's high value, like for example in the continuous productive urban landscape model, they're looking at the production of mostly high value fruits and vegetables within the city limits, because these are the things that spoil most quickly, taste better when they're fresh. So we're not talking about grains, which can be brought in from afar, but also produce the largest amount of income for the farmer. So typically, this is what you see proposed a lot, but you know, we didn't try to ask the question of how would you make the sort of Big Mac farm, if you will. But I think the sort of diversity of systems that we looked at, you know, it suggests a kind of diverse diet potentially. John?
First off, I really appreciated the talk, mm-hmm. and especially the part about the vertical farm and the staging of your critique of it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I found that was really helpful in understanding your conception of the work. And it seems to me like it's clearly the value of the work that you've done a kind of spatial analysis of the city. Mm-hmm. And found opportune moments where agriculture could intervene. And that's the scope of the work, and I appreciate that level of engagement. I'm curious at the, you know, if there's a logic of space embedded in the presentation, if there's also a logic of time and finance in it as well. And I guess I would circle that around the models of distribution. You brought up the notion of the train as enabling a certain kind of distributed model.
Right.
I understand the community model, where there's individual agency that gets the food in. I understand the corporate model, which brings it in through a larger network.
Right.
I'm just curious, in these models of deployment, what do you see as the distribution network implied by these things? Is it everybody's doing it? Are there certain people doing it? I mean, this a little outside of the scope of the work, but I'm curious
sure.
if you've thought about these sorts of issues.
We have, actually. I mean, during the studio, we consulted with several people from different fields. And you know, one of the things that often came up was it's not just about food production and consumption, but it's packaging, processing, distribution, all the sorts of things that go along with agriculture. So there would need to be a whole series of infrastructures that this kind of production mode plugs into. And you know, it's sort of hard to have the project kind of pull all of that together at once. But you know, some of the projects presented clear advantages, like the sort of the downtown model had inherent its own distribution. The idea that you set up a cart at the parking garage and, you know, distribute your food as people head home. which is sort of the extreme low-tech version. But there's also the, for example, the industrial park pasture where sheep were grazing on the rooftops of industrial parks. There was an interest in using possibly spaces, vacant spaces within the industrial park buildings as packaging and distribution centers. So exactly if that would be part of the same business or if it would be a second business that comes up next to it is unclear. Another aspect of the inner neighborhood, the urban neighborhood schemes that I didn't discuss was that the students were looking at not only the production within the neighborhood, but also packaging and sales in the sort of strip malls that occur at the edge of the neighborhoods. So the possibility that those things could sort of all overlay on each other. But clearly there is a major question of distribution because there is that kind of top-down model right now, which seems inaccessible. So would it have to be built completely from the ground up? It seems that it could be a sort of similar entrepreneurial operation if we follow this kind of premise. Clearly there is an environmental ambition to the project, which I didn't really focus too much on. But one of the things that we looked at in the studio, especially in collaboration with the landscape architects, was the idea of how inputs and outputs from the agricultural systems could get reconciled. So, and that it wasn't a kind of, often the accounting of what used to be externalities of a building's production would try to be handled within a building. So the vertical tower model, for example, proposes to generate all its own power, to become a closed system, to recycle all its water, to handle everything sort of internally. But to me, this seems, again, like it's the wrong scale at which this happens. Because of, like, an organism, for example, doesn't exist as a kind of closed system. It engages in an ecology outside of itself. So we looked at trying to establish sort of networks between projects, something I wasn't really able to get into tonight. But another thing we looked at as well was the opportunity to, especially for the big rooftop farm proposals, was the idea of introducing ecological services for the farm to support the farm and thereby also increase biodiversity and potential for animal habitat. So the necessary windbreaks for the farms that would be introduced on the ground level between the buildings, which also provide habitat, manage water runoff and filtration. These kinds of things were definitely part of our discussion. So I think they go hand in hand. It's not directly a sort of, the proposal doesn't stem directly from the idea of growing everything locally to mitigate food miles, though that is potentially a benefit. There is definitely a kind of environmental ambition to the work. Sarah.
I think when you talked about this project, you know, one question ago, talking about having what you just addressed, the issue of, you know, how do you fold in the idea of ecosystem services within the same territory, and the idea that, you know, we kind of might both be claiming these types of spaces for ecosystem services or agricultural production, but both of those ideas talk about
Right. Well, that's, I mean, it's one of the major questions, clearly. Because it's a proposal for a new kind of economy and a new sort of culture, and there's no easy answers to that question. We try to touch on it in certain specific projects more so than maybe than others. But generally, we try to avoid the idea of reliance on kind of self-sufficiency. So the sort of model that says, I'm going to farm for myself, doesn't seem viable when you have an 8 or more hour job per day, right? So that sort of was off the table. Also, we tried to look at it kind of, we tried to be sort of agnostic about what we could envision as who would be the farmer. We didn't want to be sort of too ideological about it. So for in the case of the expanding exurban farmer who makes a kind of agreement with a subdivision to utilize the backyard as strips and then develops a kind of collaborative effort whereby the neighbors sort of become stewards of their plot of land in exchange for kind of kickbacks, as the students call it, or, you know, kind of CSA, you know, a box of produce delivered from the farmer. But that is one model. Otherwise, we tended to see it as a kind of purely, we tried to see it as a kind of entrepreneurial opportunity. So we didn't know exactly who the farmer could be. We talked about it in the studio, like, what could the model be? It seems that there's several different opportunities. There's the exurban farmer who's looking for a way to expand, but doesn't have, but is spatially constrained. There's all of the agricultural knowledge that's inherent in many sort of immigrant communities, which come from places where farming is not a kind of drive and spray operation. There's this sort of interesting possibility of the management intensive grazing, which is very much a kind of information management strategy, which could present opportunities for a certain type of person to work on. So, I mean, these are important questions. We don't really have all the answers for you, but I appreciate you bringing it up.
I'm going to suggest we continue the conversation at the reception, which is taking place in the gallery at this moment.
Thank you.